Krishna, Hare Krishna, 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 Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, 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 Hare Hare. Gagroti vachalam pangulam jayate girim Kipatamahan vandese gurum dinatavidam Paramanam namadhavam Arjuna vacha Nashto mohasmati labdha Nashto mohasmati labdha Tvatprasādāṁ mayā cyutāṁ sthitosmī gata sandeha karishye vachanam dhanam. Arjuna said, "My dear Krishna, O infallible one, my illusion is now gone. I have regained my memory by your mercy. I am now firm and free from doubt, and am prepared to act according to your instructions." Purport by His Divine Grace to the Avaicharan Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada. The constitutional position of a living entity represented by Arjuna is that he has to act according to the order of the Supreme Lord. He is meant for self-discipline. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says that the actual position of the living entity is that of eternal servant of the Supreme Lord. Forgetting this principle, the living entity becomes conditioned by material nature. But in serving the Supreme Lord, he becomes a liberated servant of God. The living entity's constitutional position is to be a servitor. He has to serve either the illusory Maya, or energy, or the Supreme Lord. If he serves the Supreme Lord, he is in his normal condition. But if he prefers to serve the illusory external energy, then certainly he will be in bondage. In illusion, the living entity is serving in this material world, bound by his lusts and desires. Yet he thinks of himself as the master of the world. This is called illusion. When a person is liberated, his illusion is over, and he voluntarily surrenders unto the Supreme to act according to his desires, the Lord's desires. The last illusion, the last snare of Maya to trap the living entity, proposition that he is God. The living entity thinks that he is no longer a conditioned soul, but God. He is so unintelligent that he does not think that if he were God, then how could he be in doubt? That he does not consider. So that is the last snare of illusion. Actually, to become free from the illusory energy is to understand Krishna, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and agree to act according to His order. The word moha is very important in this verse. Moha refers to that which is opposed to knowledge. Actually, real knowledge is the understanding that every living being is eternally a servitor. But instead of thinking oneself in that position, The living entity thinks that he is not a servant, that he is the master of this material world. For he wants to lord it over the material nature. That is his illusion. This illusion can be overcome by the mercy of the Lord or by the mercy of a pure devotee. When that illusion is over, one agrees to act in Krishna consciousness. Krishna consciousness is acting according to Krishna's order. A conditioned soul, illusioned by the external energy of matter, does not know that the Supreme Lord is the Master, who is full of knowledge, and who is the proprietor of everything. Whatever he desires, he can bestow upon his devotees. He is the friend of everyone, and he is especially inclined to his devotee. He is the controller of this material nature and of all living entities. He is also the controller of inexhaustible time. And he is full of all affluences and all potencies. The Supreme Personality of Godhead can even give himself to the devotee. One who does not know him is under the spell of illusion. He does not become a devotee, but a servitor of Maya. Arjuna, however, after hearing Bhagavad-gītā from the Supreme Personality of Godhead, became free from all illusion. He could understand that Krishna was not only his friend, but that the Supreme Personality of Godhead. In other words, he could understand Krishna actually. So to study Bhagavad-gītā is to understand Krishna factually. When a person is in full knowledge, he naturally surrenders to Krishna. When Arjuna understood that it was Krishna's plan to reduce the unnecessary increase of population, he agreed to fight according to Krishna's desire. He again took off his weapons, his arrows and bow to fight under the order of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Hari Om Tat Sat. Thus ends the Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada translation and purport to the Bhagavad Gita as it is, Itopanishad. 18th chapter, 73rd verse. In the matter of the perfection of renunciation. My Bharat Sayam, my Kalgadame Ratalu. I'm coming from India. I live in Mayapur Dham, the birthplace of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. My name is Jayapataka Swami. And I'm a disciple of His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada. I'm very glad to be here. It's my first visit to Gothenburg, I think. I mean, apparently I went to the airport once. First visit here to the Hare Krishna. This is the Govindas Center. Very enlightened. I see so many wonderful devotees. Sorry for the delay. I left from a program with Rohini Sutta Prabhu and a few hundred devotees in Yugoslavia by the Hungarian border. We drove to Belgrade and reached there 1:30 in the morning and flew here via Munich. The flight was delayed. They had to take a little rest. But I do hope that I'll be able to come many times here. It's a very nice facility, nice devotees. We're reading today from the 18th chapter. This is the considered the most powerful chapter of the Bhagavad-gītā. That one can get all their spiritual desires fulfilled by this chapter. And this is like the concluding verse after Krishna told everything to Arjuna, and he told him, okay, now you can decide what you want to do. You don't have to do what I'm telling you, you can do whatever you want. According to what you do, that's how you're going to, the results are going to happen. If you do what I say, then I'll give you all the protection. If you want to do something different, well, then you'll get the karmas according to what you decide to do. But then Arjuna is saying, no, no, my illusion is completely gone. All my doubts are gone. I'm very clear now where I've decided that I'll do whatever you tell me. And so now he's prepared to take out the Lord's order. He says, I am firm and free. Stito. Stito means like fixed, firm. Sitosmi is a sandeha. Sandeha means all the doubts. And gata means like gone. All the doubts now are gone. That's the, in the beginning of the Bhagavad Gita, Arjuna surrendered to Krishna and said, Shishyateham, I am your disciple, now you guide me. And he asked so many questions. He had many doubts, many inquiries. 700 verses we covered. And now after hearing everything, now he says, all my doubts are gone. Gata sandeha. So that's really the perfection. We take a spiritual master, and if by asking him questions, we can get rid of all our doubts, all our confusion, all of our misgivings, have a really clear picture, this is what I have to do with my life, what I have to do at this time, what more can we ask for? That's what a spiritual master can do for us, give us the transcendental knowledge by which we can get out of our confusion and we can know exactly what we have to do. Spiritual life is, or yoga, it's something we have to practice. It's something that we do in order to realize the truth. But in order to fix our mind and exactly what we have to do, what is the process of yoga, which is the process suitable for us, it's very important that we have this kind of very clear guidance from a bona fide spiritual master. So this is the conclusion here, that Arjuna was successful, he achieved that. And although Arjuna used to be, I mean, he's also Krishna's friend. But friends tend to joke with each other and take things, as a friend may say something, hey, why don't you do that? You know, you take it or leave it, it's a light. So that's when Arjuna, in the beginning, he said, Shishyateham, I'm your disciple now. No, let's not talk about like it's friends anymore. Now, I want you to guide me as my spiritual master. I don't want discussion, give me absolute truth. Get me out of this illusion. I mean, the real thing is I don't know what to do. I'm very much disturbed by this whole situation. We know that basically Arjuna, he didn't want to unnecessarily kill anybody, but he was a general. And it seemed like he was being obliged to engage in a very massive warfare. And since his brother and him and his and himself would be the, if they're winners, they become the emperor in the ruling family. And if they lost, of course, if you lose, then that's a pretty horrible consequence in a war. You die with your body and everything. But then he thought, well, losing, of course, that's not a very positive alternative. And even if I win, So many people will be killed. So many of them my relatives. It's like interfacial war. Brothers and brothers and brothers. I have to fight my guru, who taught me how to fight. I have to fight my grandfather, who is for me like dearest my father. I guess he actually didn't grew up almost under the care of his grandfather. Somehow they're on the other side. There are so many factors there. He was very much confused. What is the use of winning? When I have to kill all these guys who are so dear to me, plus so many other people. So it's not worth it. There's so many social problems. There's so many. So like this year, I was in a real confusion. And he was the general on one side, so you can understand the position is really critical. But then, to get out of his confusion, he told Krishna, now I'm your disciple, you guide me. These are my doubts. And then as soon as he told Krishna, okay, now you'll be my guru, you'll be my spiritual master, you guide me. Then Krishna will say many, many very sophisticated and learned things, but no intelligent person will say those things. In other words, very nice way, he's calling him speaking like a fool. Because you don't see that what are these people who are present? First of all, they're not the bodies, they're the spirit souls in the body. So actually, nobody actually dies. There's no such thing as death in the real sense. The people are forced to leave their physical bodies and they go on to a new body, new birth, depending on their karmas and their different activities, they get a certain reaction. And so on, chapter by chapter, explain this whole science of the Bhagavad-gītā. How we can work for Krishna and get no reaction. We taught the science that of how this illusory energy works. That we are originally pure spirit beings with a living force that's in this body. For some reason or another, we misused our free will and we've decided that we want to try to lord it over the material nature. The material illusion looks very attractive, we think I want to enjoy it. But when we give up our serving attitude to Krishna, and instead we want to be in a controlling, enjoying attitude, the material nature gives us unlimited possibilities to try to satisfy our different desires. But as soon as we try to achieve one desire, we realize it's not really what I wanted, or we get it, it was pretty nice, but then all of a sudden it's already gone. And like this, we're just running after one thing after another, and it never ends. And we stay into this illusion. When somebody realizes that I'm not meant to enjoy this material world, because by nature I'm really a servant of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. When I serve Krishna, then actually I become happy. Trying to follow these different permutations of the material illusion never makes anybody permanently happy. One goes from happiness to distress, distress to happiness, happiness goes on. Always in a state of flux, nothing is permanent here. Most of the time we're suffering. Now, one thing is that in Europe I found out that when it gets hot here, you're not prepared for heat. India gets hot. There were reasons in the newspaper, it's very hot in India. In India, we are prepared for heat. Every room has fans. Like that room, that's like a little bit of a thing. I'll probably use the example. In the summer, you get a fan, it's very nice, a little cooling. In the winter, it's -20 or something, you don't need a fan because it's so hot there. I was this year, it's cooler here in Sweden. I was just in, it was in the 30s, upper 30s in Yugoslavia. And also, they were in a tent, it was like a sauna. There's no fans. India, even if they build a tent, they have fans. it's the summer. So, at least India is not prepared for cold. It was prepared for heat. Here, you're very well prepared when it gets cold. I was here in the winter and it was right at minus something, 20 or something. All the rooms are well heated and double the doors. But here is heat. We have a short summer, but we have a short winter. So that's it. But according to the time, now in the summer you like air conditioning, or you like some fan, it's very nice. But in the winter, you don't. Nobody's using the heaters. So this is the illusion that the same thing that makes us happy now will make us suffer another time. So it's that you can make one environment, you may have a nice environment for the taking off the heat. When it gets to be the winter, then all those fans are in the heaters. And here, right, so you may have all the heaters along the wall, you have so many heaters. But this is how cool you down. So this is the illusion that we make some arrangement. Of course, you know, if you really have it together, then you have heaters and air conditioners, and then you have to pay the electric bill, energy bills, ecological considerations. So there's no easy solution. Everything in the material world is turns out to be a bit somewhat complex. When we understand that this is not the basis of my happiness. Sometimes I'm going to be materially happy, and sometimes I'm not going to be materially happy. I'm going to have some inconvenience. Is that important? Because we're getting a happiness from a totally different platform, different level. When I see how nice you're all chanting and dancing Hare Krishna, you have such a feeling of transcendental bliss. That spiritual happiness is based on a totally different experience. And somebody who hasn't tried it, they won't know. It's something one has to experience. That's what's special about Bhakti Yoga. Bhakti Yoga is an immersion. You get totally immersed in the thoughts of Krishna. Krishna's absolute truth. So if you do, for instance, Ashtanga Yoga, the different levels of yoga, Karma Yoga, Ashtanga Yoga, and finally the topmost yoga is Bhakti Yoga. This morning, maybe for yesterday, Vahini Sutta Prabhu, one of our Iskand Gurus, he was sharing with the devotees how he became a devotee. So he became a devotee in 1974. And he said that he used to listen to George Harrison. So he read in some introduction to some CD or the album or something, where he said like the progression, you go from Jnana to Karma to Ashtanga to finally the Bhakti. So he remembered that. That when he came to he met some devotees for the first time, and they started talking to him about Bhakti Yoga. He said, "Oh yeah, that's the topmost one. I remember reading about that by George Harrison." And within 3 days, he was chanting 16 rounds, and he took up Bhakti Yoga fully. 3 days, he was into it. It's a bit of a shock treatment, you were saying that. So I told him to chant 16 rounds, third day. He was sharing that. So sometimes, people, they try one yoga, but other yogas take a long time. But every yoga is meant to get absorbed in the meditation. But through the eighth level yoga, the mystical yoga, you do asanas, you do pranayama, and then gradually you get some concentration after you learn how to control yourself, a very simple life, good diet, and everything, then eventually you can get some concentration. That's what these different eight levels are. Ending in that final level is samadhi, trance, in total absorption on the Absolute Truth. But in the bhakti yoga, just by this chanting and dancing, which one can even walk off the street and do within an hour or 20 minutes, even sometimes within a few minutes, depends how, if you're regularly used to chant, you can fix the mind very quickly. In some of you, it may take a slight bit more time. But within a fairly short period of time, one can get the mind focused. And that is also samadhi. And they can start to experience spiritual awareness, which is not dependent on the senses, it's not dependent on the mind. Usually our happiness is dependent on the sense. If it's a nice day out, we feel if it's rainy, stormy, then we feel another way. It's all by our sensual perception. But here, we're getting a happiness in Krishna consciousness which is not dependent upon the senses, contacting some sense object. In fact, it's totally out of our control. We may suddenly feel like laughing, we may feel like crying, we may feel like our ears are standing on end, or some kind of spiritual emotion which is not due to any other visible reason of contact with some material thing. Because of our contact on a spiritual platform with Krishna. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he used to demonstrate that and chant with his devotees many, many hours. And he would become so ecstatic that he would start to do things which were obviously out of his control. He couldn't control how the tears were pouring from his eyes or how his voice would become choked up. Lord Chaitanya was really experiencing this highest ecstasy. What happened is after some time, people saw that looking for who's got the highest ecstasy. He's the guru that I want. So then you got some people that started to imitate the ecstasies, like actors, in order to attract followers. But they weren't actually experiencing the ecstasy, they just were showing the symptoms of the ecstasy. In fact, we saw one person in India used to put in the back, in his like dressing room, he put chilies up his nose. And he'd go out and it was burning in the nose and tears would be flowing down and then people say, wow, and he's really filled with love. He got so much ecstasy. He must have been a really yogi to keep the chilies in his nose. So our grandfather guru, he said that he made a standard program that we shouldn't show the ecstasy as much as possible. Just try to internalize it. So not make the whole thing cheap and then everybody thinks that they can just show it and that's it. Because there's other ways you can tell if somebody's in ecstasy. If somebody's experiencing the ecstasy, they'll be so satisfied with themselves, with their own spiritual practices that but naturally you start to develop all kinds of nice qualities like being tolerant when there's unfavorable circumstances, when they're criticized, when people... Usually if somebody tells us, you know, you're a wonderful person, you know, we like to hear that. Oh, glad you noticed. But if somebody tells us, you're our rascal number one, you know, you're good for nothing or something, then, you know, start feeling really down. Especially if it's someone we know, or if some stranger shouts some obscene to us, doesn't mean to. But if it's someone you know, then it affects you. So especially if it's like some very near and dear. So this ego, and it's getting inflated or deflated, that's something that normally affects people very severely. But if somebody's on a transcendental satisfied platform, then they're not affected if somebody praises them, they're not affected if people criticize them. Just for some superficial thing. And there are like many different qualities like this. You can start to distinguish this person's always busy in spiritual life. They don't waste time doing things which are not connected to Krishna. Somehow, they're doing things which are always connected to the spiritual practice. So, these are called anubhavas, and these you cannot imitate very easily. Symptoms you can imitate, but these are the results of spiritual maturity. So, this is someone who wants to be able to distinguish who is actually spiritually advanced. There are symptoms they can watch for. 11 symptoms are mentioned in Chaitanya Charitamrita. If you'd like. And this is where one can start to recognize who is actually spiritually advanced. But because at some period in time people just start showing external things, you can, even a good actor, on the drop of a hat, they teach you how to cry. And they think of the worst thing in your life, the most horrible thing, you know, your grandfather you loved so much, he passed away. A good actor, you really just focus on something, start bawling and crying tears before you. That's acting. That's not, but that doesn't, then they can change in a minute and they feel something else. You see, sometimes in some movies you have a person who plays 2-3 roles, and some of them are totally opposite. So one minute he's in one way, next minute it's another way. So that's not what we're talking about. We're talking about really spiritually experiencing true satisfaction and deep realization. So Srila Prabhupada, many times, he was always an ecstasy. I never saw a time when he wasn't really spiritually very blissful. But he wouldn't show. Like that's why sometimes you see this very grave face, or everything in that face, but he was a very grave face. Some people think, oh, it doesn't look happy. He was so happy. But he's so happy that that was another kind of happiness, like a really deep, profound happiness. But sometimes even his emotions would just go out of control. I remember once it was Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur's, our grandfather, my grandfather Guru's disappearance day, and Prabhupada was saying how much he appreciated how all the previous acharyas had done things to develop Mayapur, and how he was also trying to develop Mayapur, the birthplace of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, and how much he appreciated all the devotees who are helping him to develop Mayapur. And like when he said that, then he just choked up. He couldn't speak anymore. Tears were pouring from his eyes. He was just stunned, and he couldn't, he was out of control. Only after some time that he got the devotees to chant Hare Krishna, and he could recover his. One time he was at Atlanta, arriving from Mexico City in Caracas, and he was there, and there were hundreds of devotees present, and he was before the boarding party, beautiful ladies they have in Atlanta like this, and when he saw him, he said, you don't understand how fortunate you all are, how merciful Lord Nityananda are. They have come here just to bless all of you. They're the most merciful incarnations. And then while he was explaining about the mercy of Lord Chaitanya, he lost control and he just started to cry. And he couldn't speak anymore for a while. Then he was singing that song for the first time, Parama Karuna Prabhu Dujana. Nithai Gaura Chandra Savyavataya Sarasiramani Kevalananda Kanda. And then Gorakhpur in India, when he met Hanuman Podar, Hanuman Prasad Podar, and then he was doing a program there before the Radhamana Deities that are in Mayapur now, but at that time they were traveling with him. And he was talking about Lord Chaitanya meeting with Sarupa, with Sanatan Goswami, and how it was like Krishna meeting with the gopis after a long separation, and it was such an extremely emotional moment for Sanatan Goswami to meet with Lord Chaitanya. And when they met, and Lord Chaitanya just embraced and gave him a hug, that both of them started to cry in ecstasy, Lord Chaitanya and Sanatan Goswami. When Prabhupada was explaining this, he also got choked up and he started to cry. He couldn't speak for a while. So we'd like all of you to experience this transcendental ecstasy. That's done by a systematic. Like every one of you to experience this spiritual bliss. I hope many of you already have. And the more and more you can experience it. And the knowledge which dispels all the illusions. As Arjuna systematically read the Bhagavad-gītā, and all of his questions answered, now at the final conclusion he said, now I'm firm in my determination, I'm clear in my consciousness, all my doubts are gone. You know how strong it makes one feel? When you're really clear, okay, this is what I have to do. Because the doubt is really what weakens us. So what am I supposed to do now? What's the proper thing? Not only that, he knows that he has all the power of Krishna behind him. And Krishna has unlimited power. He knows what he has to do. He knows that in order to do this, Krishna is fully behind him. Because I'm doing what Krishna wants. I mean, I don't know if this is a good example. Just something comes to mind. Just think how on the opposite thing, you read the newspapers now. How, like you have these American soldiers who are in Iraq. They went there in order to carry out the order of their president and their country's agenda and to protect their country and all this. Now they're sitting there in 50-degree weather, and they've never been trained to do a peacekeeping operation. They've never been trained to do policing operation. They've never been trained to do nation building. They were just trained to kill people and be soldiers and professional soldiers. They did pretty good at that. But now they're in a situation and they're getting frustrated. They're told they can go back as soon as the war is over. War is over. And they're sitting there and they're getting picked off by all the guerrilla warriors. And it's like, so they're like in the opposite situation. They put their faith in something and when you read the newspapers, they don't feel very supported by that. This is a problem that in this material world, we make a decision and go forward and find out that it's not what it was told to me. Everything's different. Doesn't work out. But in the situation Arjuna is in, because he's actually understood now what Krishna wants, and Krishna has the full potency to give the full backing, whatever has to be done, he can fully supply all the ingredients and all the requisites to achieve all the success. But it's I don't know, maybe it's a bad example, or just something topical that came to mind. Just, I'd like to share one other thing with you, of course, is how this 18 chapters I mentioned in the beginning is considered the most powerful of all the chapters. I'm not saying this, but Lord Shiva, he said this in the Purana to Parvati. He mentioned that 18th chapter, that it is very, very dear to Krishna, and it is the conclusion of the whole Bhagavad Gita. And if somebody chants the 18th chapter verses, it's very, very powerful. So Parvati wanted to have she's a personified maternal energy. She wanted to have an example. So then Lord Shiva told an example about the glories of the 18th chapter. Have you heard that? You heard it?
In Chile.
In Chile. Anybody here? The others have heard it? Would you like to hear it?
Yes.
Yeah. What do you think?
Yes.
Okay. So, it starts out that Lord Indra. Lord Indra, he's the king of the celestial universe. There's the three worlds. He's like having the king of the angels that run this universe on a higher level. And he gets there because he does a lot of religious activities when he's on earth. So he gets to serve as that chief angel in this on that level. There's higher levels, but at this level he's the chief. So there he's seated as the king in heaven, and he's being glorified by so many other celestial beings, how he's really a great person, how he did so many wonderful things. And he's sitting there and having all kind of cultural programs, dancing, views, and great sages and yogis who are able to travel on a higher level. They're also appreciating him. And he's in his capital city, which was in a place called Amaravati, on the side of the mystical Mount Meru. So then, in his royal assembly in the back, two messengers from the spiritual world appear. They're called Vishnu Dutas. They're personal messengers from the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Vishnu. That's why they call Vishnu Dutas. Duta means messenger. Like ambassadors or something from the Supreme Lord. In India, they call an ambassador Duta. Country. And they used to call Rajdut when they were the kings. Now it's Rashtra country instead of king. No more king. So they were Vishnu Dutas. They came along and they carrying one Brahmana from this planet, one priestly man. And Indra is, well, he's just a servant of the Supreme Lord. In charge of this one part of the universe. So he actually, when he sees the ambassadors from the Supreme Lord coming, he got off his throne to receive them and find out what's the news, what's happened. And so they're walking right up to him, and he said, "Welcome, how can I help you?" And then they walked right by him, picked up this Brahmana, put him on the royal seat of Indra. He transforms and he becomes himself Indra. And everybody looks and see the old Indra, suddenly he's like no longer Indra anymore. He's ex-Indra. Just got laid off. Like some of the air companies are laying off their pilots. He just got laid off. Everybody said, glorifying the Indra, Daya Indra Deva, glories Indra Deva, glories to the new Indra Deva. It's like, long live the king. The king is dead, long live the king. Long live Indra, Indra is going out. Long live Indra. So the ex-Indra, he was really frustrated. He said, "What's going on here? I mean, how did I lose my job?" He's like, boom, just like that. And he was very frustrated, and he was asking everybody, look at the Supreme Lord. You know, I mean, he sent his messengers, and they put a group around.
Thank you for watching our videos. Be sure to subscribe to our channel. We publish new videos every day, and don't forget to like and share our channel.